Well, welcome everyone to this semi-annual meeting of the sponsored by the National Center for the Study of University Engagement, the University Outreach and Engagement. I'm High Fitzgerald, Associate Provost of University Outreach and Engagement, and I'm going to surprise my staff by actually reading one of the talking points that they give me, because as they know, I usually don't. And I'm going to read it because I thought it was actually written pretty good. The Office of University Outreach and Engagement ensures that Michigan State University's outreach efforts are internally coordinated, externally linked, responsive to important societal issues, and consistent with its mission and policies. I thought that was pretty good because it really captures what University Outreach and Engagement Office is all about in the Provost Office. Before I introduce our speaker of the day, I do want to draw attention to Bert Bargerstock and Diane Zimmerman, who can't be here because she has some health issues at the moment. Last week, Bert was in Vancouver and attending a conference of the University Continuing Education Association. And he and Diane represented Michigan State University and the work that a team of folks here did in developing what we call the Outreach Engagement Measurement Instrument, the OEMI, which is a tool to enable faculty to report their engagement activities in research, teaching, and service. And it's a tool that's currently being used at the University of Tennessee System, University of Kentucky, Kansas State University, and in a pilot study with the American College of Pharmacy, and soon to be used worldwide. And they received the 2007 Recognition of Excellence Award for Innovations in Outreach and Engagement. So Bert, congratulations on that. I also want to recognize our co-sponsors of the day's events. And it's the Michigan Head Start Association, the Michigan Head Start State Collaboration Office, the Michigan State University Department of Anthropology, the Michigan State University American Indian Studies, the Native American Institute, in Michigan State University's College of Agricultural and Natural Resources, and the Intertribal Council on Michigan Head Start. So thanks to all those folks for helping us put this day together and to bring Paul here. Now, Paul. Paul Spicer is a Michiganian, born and raised here. Unfortunately, he's also a Wolverine. Paul earned his bachelor's degree at the University of Michigan with distinction and very high honors in anthropology, went on to the University of Minnesota, where he became a different animal, a badger. Or no, what are they?
Gopher.
We don't know badger, a gopher. And got his master's degree and his PhD in anthropology. I met Paul in 1996, right after he finished his doctorate, where he was a member of the University of Colorado research team involved with the National Evaluation of Early Head Start. He had gone to the University of Colorado Health Sciences as a member of their research faculty, and is still there. He's an associate professor at the University of Colorado Health Sciences. He linked, when he first went there, with Bob Emdy, who was a professor of psychiatry at the same institution. Just to give you a sense of the incestuous nature of academics, Bob Emdy was a resident at the University of Colorado Medical Center. It wasn't health sciences then, it was a medical center. At the same time, I was a graduate student at the University of Denver, and he and I met them because my mentor, Yvonne Brackbill, Bob went to her in order to try to get some training in research methodology with infants because he had not had that kind of training in his psychiatry education. And so we met in the mid-1960s, Bob and I, and then Paul comes with him to this research team, and Paul and I have been collaborators on that kind of early Head Start work. Paul quickly became part of the steering committee of the National Evaluation of Early Head Start while he was with that team. He has published extensively in peer-reviewed journals. He has published 3 chapters, soon to be 4, and they are in just extraordinary books. I happen to be the editor of all those books, so you don't ever publish another chapter in this one. Paul's research interests are focused on disadvantaged populations and with a special interest in American Indians. They cut across addiction issues, obesity issues, health care issues, culturally appropriate practices. And I'm delighted that he is with us today, and he's going to share his work with us.
Thank you. It's good to be back in Michigan, actually. I don't know if you often hear that, but it actually is. You have trees, you have water. It's quite striking when you come from the high plains where I now live. What I want to do is just take the next 40 minutes or so to just provide a broad overview of the set of programs that we've developed at the University of Colorado School of Medicine, and to talk about some specific innovations, and I use that in the standard academic sense of things that probably won't impress most of you, but changes that we've tried to introduce in the way that we conduct health research in American Indian, Alaska Native communities in the time that I've been there. We now call ourselves the American Indian, Alaska Native Programs. When I joined, we were 3 centers, and only one of which had substantial resources. We have grown tremendously since then in the 12 years that I've been there. Our programs are headed by Spiro Manson, who's Pembina Chippewa from Turtle Mountain, North Dakota. He's also an anthropologist by training, actually trained at Minnesota 20 years before I did, has been working in psychiatry ever since. We currently have 6 different national centers devoted in various ways to a broad range of activity, including research, information dissemination, technical assistance, and specifically research training is the center we have. We also have a clinical psychology internship program for clinical training. And we have numerous additional individual research projects. As we were talking over lunch, I realized that there might be some interest in the work that I've done in alcoholism, so I'll try and mention that in passing. I've had a couple of grants from NIAAA that I wasn't planning to talk about, but that I will. I'm a cultural anthropologist by training, and I've been on the faculty. This is the only job I've had at the University of Colorado since 1995 when I defended my dissertation and came to join a study of psychiatric epidemiology that they were just beginning. Our programs began with a mental health research center funded by the National Institute of Mental Health, and that was funded in 1985. We are finishing up the no-cost extension for our funding for years 15 to 20 on that center, and are currently trying to get funding for years 21 to 25, but are having difficulty persuading people that we need it anymore, given how successful we've become. Our past programs include running the National Program Office for the Healthy Nations Program of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, which was a series of initiatives for a total of 16, I think in the end, 17 different Native communities, urban and tribal communities alike, who are developing comprehensive approaches to deal with the epidemic of substance abuse in their communities. We also had a resource center for Native elders that was funded by the Administration on Aging. And another center of ours, which is, we're winding down, is an Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality funded center that was focused on healthcare disparities for the elderly. These are our past efforts, and there's some reason to believe that we may be adding our mental health center to that as well. Our current centers include the Circles of Care Evaluation and Technical Assistance Center. This is a SAMHSA-funded initiative that I'm not going to talk about for the rest of this talk, so let me just give you a little bit of detail. For those of you who don't know, SAMHSA is the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. They have a program, this is specifically the Center for Mental Health Services, they have a program that is designed to help communities develop systems of care for children with severe emotional and behavioral disturbances. They had a number of Native applicants who were not successful in competing for those large systems grants, so they created the Circles of Care initiative to prepare Native grantees to successfully compete for those grants. We are partnered with NICWA, the National Indian Child Welfare Association in Portland, Oregon, who handles the program side as communities think about what kind of program integration is needed for these children. And we handle the evaluation side because both components are required by CMHS to compete for these large systems grants. The Native Elder Research Center I will talk about has become a model for our junior faculty training program, which is one of, I think, the exciting new approaches that we've developed in the time that I've been there that allows Native investigators the time they need to develop research careers. That was originally funded by the National Institute on Aging, is now funded by several additional sources. The Center on American Indian and Alaska Native Health Disparities is part of the relatively newly created initiative at the National Center for Minority Health and Health Disparities, which is a full center designed to conduct research and research training related to disparities that affect American Indian and Alaska Native people. The Center for Native American Telehealth and Teleeducation is actually our only center that doesn't have a center grant to support it. It's actually the center that allowed us to create our Native Health building on our new campus in Aurora at the Fitzsimmons, former Fitzsimmons Army Medical Center, and reflects our commitment to securing access for remote reservation communities to specialty care, which they don't have on-site in person using real-time video conferencing. And then our Coordinating Center for Research on the Special Diabetes Programs for Indians is actually, in terms of dollars, our largest effort and involves coordination of research activities around two interventions for people with Native people with diabetes. One that's designed to prevent cardiovascular disease in people who already have diabetes, the other that's designed to prevent diabetes in people who are at risk for diabetes. And we have 66 tribal and urban partners as part of that effort. And then finally is the center that I direct, which we were funded for in 2005, which I will talk some about at the end of this talk, the American Indian Alaska Native Head Start Research Center, which is designed to respond to a failure from in previous efforts to initiate research in tribal Head Start and early Head Start programs. Some of you are no doubt familiar with the situation in American Indian health. American Indian Alaska Native communities are regularly identified, some communities such as Pine Ridge, are regularly identified as among the poorest in the country, if not the poorest in the country. They, in most cases, deal with a dramatically underfunded healthcare system. In fact, the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights was commissioned to do a report on the predicaments in Indian health as a civil rights issue because they are so dramatically underfunded. And that's especially the case when it comes to any specialty care at all. My colleague Doug Novins, who's a child and adolescent psychiatrist, did a survey a decade ago now of the number of dedicated doctoral level clinicians specializing in child and adolescent mental health. Those of you who know Indian country know there are 12 different IHS service areas that serve 500 different tribal communities. There were four. So there are four child and adolescent mental health professionals at the doctoral level to serve all of the 500 American Indian Alaska Native communities. And that's just one of many striking examples of how little we devote to the care of the First Nations of this continent. Numerous health problems occur with much greater frequency in American Indian Alaska Native communities than anywhere else in any other population, and that includes trauma, alcoholism, and diabetes. The Pima of Gila River are regularly reported as having the highest rates of diabetes of any community. our documentation of rates of alcoholism in three tribal communities are the highest ever reported in the literature that uses community samples and a rigorous measurement approach. There are higher estimates, but they're somewhat suspect, I think, especially in light of the work we've done. But the work we've done still suggests that there is no other population in the world that has greater rates of alcoholism than some American Indian communities. Trauma, they certainly, there are other populations that are as impacted by trauma as American Indian communities, but the rates are again dramatically elevated. We often lack the most basic information though about what to do in terms of healthcare intervention. And this is, I think, a very interesting paradox in research in American Indian health. Whenever we go to talk to communities about new studies, they're like, oh, you again. All you ever want to do is do studies. So people feel that they've been researched to death, that they're plagued by studies, and we're almost like a locust on American Indian communities. But we know next to nothing of value in helping them to address their healthcare disparities. One possibility is that they're plagued by a bunch of really bad research. And I certainly think you'd level that criticism on some of the studies that have found their way into the literature, and I suspect, you know, a lot of the bad studies don't find their way into the literature. But, you know, we've done, I think, some pretty good research, and as have others of our colleagues. And so I think probably more the fundamental problem is that people are coming to do studies that don't translate into healthcare improvement and don't really have any prospect of translating into healthcare improvement for Native communities. And what I want to focus on is some ways that we can begin to address that gap between what we need to know and what we do know by more effectively partnering with communities. Just to give you an example, I wanted to give you some updated statistics on mortality, differences in mortality in American Indian Alaska Native communities. The IHS used to regularly report, abstracting from the National Health Statistics, American Indian mortality. I went to the website just this morning, and again, as I suspected would be the case, the most recent reports are from the late 90s, and that's from mortality data from the mid-90s. So there are some very severe data shortages in American Indian health that we as researchers really should be ashamed of and have an obligation to correct. I want to couch this in terms of research ethics, because I think fundamentally these are ethical questions. And we've initiated a line of research on how research gets done in American Indian Alaska Native communities. And let me just preface this by saying, and I shared this with someone I met with earlier today. At one point, when we were trying to enlist broader community participation in this program of research, I went to talk to a group of tribal chairmen in the Aberdeen area, which they represent tribes from North Dakota, South Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. And I went to them. Their executive director was keen to capitalize on the opportunity that was represented by this line of research, and so she wanted me to come talk to the tribal chairman about how they might get involved in this. And we had gotten the message pretty early on in our own research that when we're talking about tribal regulation of research, a university is probably not the best one to be hosting that conversation. The tribe should really be hosting that conversation. But as almost from the moment I started talking about how we could do research on research, you could see the jaws drop on tribal chairman. And I didn't get more than a minute into the presentation of this research opportunity, and the chair of that tribal chairman's health board said to me, excuse me, I need to ask you this. Do you really mean to say that we should be doing research on research? And he said that with a tone that indicated quite clearly to me that he could imagine nothing more irrelevant to his people. And I had spent the day in the tribal chairman's health board meeting listening to them discuss much more pressing priorities than how to regulate research in their communities. They were fighting for basic healthcare necessities for their people with the medical director of the Indian Health Service, who had just earlier in the day announced to them that the increase to the NIH budget in that year had been larger than his entire budget for Indian healthcare that year. So it was pretty clear that research was monopolizing some resources, and here we wanted to do something that he couldn't imagine being less relevant. I don't think probably anybody who's in the room for a series on the Engaged Scholar believes that research is that irrelevant, or that thinking about how to do research better is that irrelevant. But we do face some opposition. And I do think these are fundamental ethical questions. We have had, in the American Indian Alaska Native programs, very long-standing experience in negotiating approval for research in tribal jurisdictions. I assure you that we have never done a study in a tribe without the full authorization of all appropriate tribal authorities. So we have invested a fair amount of energy into thinking about and working with tribal councils to make sure that folks are adequately apprised of the goals of the research and understand what they're involved in. We have also, from well before I joined our faculty, had a thorough commitment to community involvement in all phases of the research. All our projects are staffed locally. We have field offices that are now in operation well into their second decade, and in some cases may even be in their third decade of continuous operation. Indeed, several of our local staff have made careers of working in our field offices and on our projects, and we have a hierarchy that they progress up in the field offices. We always are in the situation of using measures that nobody developed with Indian people in mind. And so we regularly sit down and review the entire battery of measures that we propose to use in our studies and modify them and develop new ones as needed. And we have we've always had a commitment to community feedback, and what I want to share with you later on in the presentation is some of the ways in which we've elaborated on that. But we've always had a commitment to giving back the results of our research to communities. I shared with, I guess it was a group at lunch today, our commitment to community confidentiality. Some of you may be familiar with what happened in Barrow, Alaska, in the wake of a study on the impact of oil revenue on alcohol consumption in the Arctic Circle. It was a small, obscure report in the research literature that probably wouldn't have caused any trouble had it lingered there, as most of our findings do. But the New York Times picked it up because it's kind of a sensational finding. In retrospect, we should have known this. It was not our study, but researchers should have known in retrospect this would have been sensational, because the finding was that as people's income increased, their alcohol consumption increased. And so the New York Times picked the story up, ran the story identifying the community, which was identified in the report and the research. And those of you who know Native Alaska know that these are corporations. And they depend on loans to finance a great deal of what they plan to do in terms of community development. Their bond rating plummeted overnight in the wake of that story. And they were no longer, they had to shelve numerous community development initiatives that they had planned, because they were identified. You know what, I can't imagine a bank that would want to loan money to a community that was full of alcoholics. That is a very bad risk. And that's how the finding was interpreted in the literature, and that was the real consequence for that community. We do a lot of research in alcohol, drug, and mental health issues. There's very real danger that we would stigmatize those particular communities if they were to be identified. And so Spiro led an effort to understand what had gone wrong in the case of that report in the literature, and to identify ways of better protecting communities. And where I'm heading is a line of research that we've initiated with funds that are part of the genome effort. We knew going into this effort that there were concerns about genetics in Native communities. There are probably no population in the United States that is more sensitized to the risks of genetics than American Indian Alaska Native communities, because of their long involvement with physical anthropology and population genetics, and the ways in which that knowledge and those interpretations are used to undermine claims to territory, claims to identity, and the like, the way in which they play out in efforts to secure federal recognition. So Native people have long been sensitized to the risks of genetic research, and indeed, with Native people who led the opposition to the Human Genome Diversity Project, which was an effort to catalog human genetic diversity. And Native people of North America were in the lead in opposing that for these reasons. But we figured that we had spent enough time doing research and thinking about the issues involved in research in American Indian Alaska Native communities that we could get involved in and perhaps advance some of the debates around genetics, recognizing that we worked in a medical school surrounded by colleagues who thought the genome was the answer to everything, and that American Indian and Alaska Native communities might want to participate in some of that research if they were to participate in some of the benefits of that work. In 1999, there was an RFA to do research on human genetic variation. As you know, it was 2000, 2001, it may have been 2002, where we announced that we had the human genome. But it's not the human genome, it's a human genome. And we only had one sequence. And so we didn't really know at that time, still really don't today, how we vary from each other. And so the next logical step in the science of genomics was to begin to understand that variation. And as part of that, they had funded this effort to look at some of the implications around research on human genetic variation. The major emphasis of that project was understanding people's hopes and concerns about genetic studies, and to work with tribal leadership to think about what kinds of protections might make sense. And it was in that context that I was visiting with these tribal chairmen that I was telling you about. Has anybody heard of the ELSI program, know about the ELSI program? I was calling around originally as I was convening a large working group of investigators who were doing genomic research. People started pronouncing this acronym when I was talking to them, and I'm like, what are they talking about, ELSI? What is this? I'm talking about ethical, legal, and social implications. And then I realized that they were pronouncing that. And that's what it stands for. It's a program at NIH that is devoted to research on ethical, legal, and social implications. And it was started as part of the genome effort when James Watson was leading the Center on Human Genomics, where he set aside 3% of the budget for the sequencing effort to talk to publics about their concerns and understandings about genetics, and it's subsequently been increased to 5%. It's well into its second decade now of funded research. And they've done work on a broad range of issues, including some very innovative work around genetic privacy and discrimination, thinking about consent and protection issues for stored tissues, which can be used for any number of purposes once they're stored, and a wide range of issues in terms of how you deliver genetic services and what the implications are for families in particular, since knowledge of one person's genome inevitably sheds light on other people's. Our ELSI project was called, when we were limited to 56 characters, we called it The Promises and Pitfalls of Native Genetic Research, and we intended to focus specifically on medical applications of genetics. We began with a conference to explore the various positions that had been articulated in debates about the genome, and then we wanted to work to identify what existing research protections were out there for tribes, and then to work with tribal leaders and health directors to really understand how those were sufficient, where they had failed, and what steps we might need to take to make those stronger. And then we also wanted to really, you know, we have a lot of, in these debates, we have a lot of advocates saying, my people don't want this. It's much less clear what a broad population survey actually would indicate. And so we wanted to gain some understanding of what broader public opinion about genetics was. Our conference was held at our Given Institute, which is a university facility we have in Aspen, Colorado, in April of 2001. We had representatives from 30 to 40 different tribes, two former directors from the Indian Health Service. We had researchers from numerous universities, although interestingly, most of the people doing genomic research were at the time intramural researchers at NIH rather than folks in universities. We had the most prominent critics of genetic research, all of them, and we had more attorneys than I have ever seen. Interestingly, the ELSI program is one of the few places that people with JDs do get funded by NIH, and there are a number of very prominent legal researchers who have been funded by ELSI research, and given our interest in tribal law and the ability of tribes to regulate research, it made sense that there were a lot of attorneys, although I have to say I was a little nervous I'd get sued. So, I still am. So just some highlights from these early conversations. There was tremendous anger in this room from almost any Native person we had. People feel betrayed by researchers, ignored by research funders. We were lucky, I think, at points. I mean, I think people spent the whole weekend on edge, and I think some people were honestly quite scared by the level of anger. There was a very persistent sense that Native communities and perspectives have been marginalized as treating it nicely. I think they feel that they've really been ignored. In particular, they feel betrayed by researchers and research institutions who come in with a lot of promises about what a study's going to do for the community. And, you know, let alone the disappointing nature of research that sometimes what you hope to find you don't find, they simply don't know what happens to the studies. Nobody ever comes back to tell them what has happened, let alone to use that knowledge to generate something meaningful. These were the themes of our conversation. Researchers, in the face of this this considerable negative affect shut up. Basically, we didn't have any of the dialogue I had hoped we would have. The researchers just said, okay, I'm not going to talk because I know what's going to happen to me if I try and talk. The dialogue really was very one-sided, and that was very unfortunate, I think. Obviously, if we fail to engage communities around why they are so angry about research, we're not going to keep doing research. And from the perspective of many people in the room, that's fine. But I think those of you who are researchers should find it striking that we don't know anything about the health status of Native people in the 21st century. Genetic studies in particular are a great risk, both because of the risk that they pose for Native people, and also because they seem to be so irrelevant to the healthcare concerns of Native communities. One of the examples that came up repeatedly in these discussions was the Pima Diabetes Project. NIDDK has an office in the Phoenix area where they work with Phoenix area Oodham communities looking at diabetes. And for as long as we've been able to look at genes, they've been looking at genes. And people pointed out that despite 10 years at the time of investment in genetic knowledge on diabetes in these communities, the epidemic had done nothing but worsen. So that this knowledge appeared to be not only irrelevant, it appeared to be, it's expensive, and it appeared to be squandering resources that would be much better used in changing physical activity and nutrition. And the other conclusion I drew, in light of this critique of basic research, and again, I don't think this would surprise anybody in a room who's here to talk about engagement, is that if research has a place at all, the way in which it has a place is probably explicitly focused on intervention services and policy. At the same time that there was this withering negative sentiment about researchers, though, the room was full of researchers who are involved in basic research on American Indian health, often with a very explicit genetic focus. And they've been able to do that despite the concerns that Native people have about genetics. Tribes regularly enlist, and repeatedly, and despite these disappointments, regularly enlist to participate in research on health conditions that are of concern in their communities. And in fact, although the research on diabetes was singled out for special criticism, there are some very real examples where genetics has made a difference for the healthcare of Native people. And one of the most striking examples that we discussed at our conference is something that came to be characterized as Athabascan skin, which was originally described in the Navajo population, where they were able to do prenatal diagnosis to determine who was going to be born with this severe combined immune deficiency, and then to do the bone marrow transplant immediately from birth, and to create conditions around the birth of the child so that the child didn't suffer life-threatening infections at birth. So there are some cases where already, as little as we know about the genome, where it has made a difference. So while researchers are widely resented, and many people would like to see us just get out of the way and leave our money behind, there are many important health problems for which research can make very important contributions. As I said, we know next to nothing about some of the most basic questions you could imagine. And it remains possible to conduct research if you think about the right conduct of research, which is, I think, what makes it an ethical question. We are probably, in the country, the major research enterprise in American Indian Alaska Native health. Johns Hopkins does a lot of work, but I think we're bigger, and we're certainly, I think, in a broader range of communities. And so people had us in mind when they were talking about research and the way in which research has failed them. Even when it wasn't about us, we took it personally, because that's how we make a living. I only received two compliments the whole weekend. This was actually my second R01, but the first time I'd ever tried anything like this. And one of our tribal council members who was there said, "Well, you sure know how to take criticism." So I thought, "Well, that's good," but that was just in the meeting. I think the real test of how you take criticism is what you do with it. And what we did is we had all of our senior investigators at these meetings. As we sat down immediately after that event, in part we were motivated because we thought we had devastated all of our junior faculty and they were all going to quit. And so we wanted to sit down and think through some of these issues and help them talk about, how they were thinking of making a living in American Indian Alaska Native health research. But we also needed to think about how we were proceeding and how we did our business. one of the things that was immediately apparent in that criticism that researchers just fly in, talk up their studies and leave and don't tell you anything about whatever happened with the study, is that we needed much broader and more sustained community engagement in thinking about the kind of research that gets done. And that now includes regular participation in ongoing community dialogues by our faculty around health and wellness issues. And we've had several proposals, including one that I'll talk about in a bit, that's one that I'm leading, that have emerged directly from that dialogue and would not have occurred otherwise. We also, in recognition of how people felt betrayed at the back end of research, created, elaborated, and extended our procedures for community feedback, including creating for those tribes that hadn't previously requested it procedures for tribal review and approval of publications and presentations. And more recently, as I said over lunch, have really moved to explicit models of co-authorship. One of the things that intrigues us about co-authorship versus a language of contracts is that those of you who know offices of grants and contracts sponsored programs at universities know that they have a particular attitude towards intellectual freedom in contracts, and that's motivated by the way in which pharmaceutical companies may attempt to suppress results. When you include language that tribes often are interested in terms of giving them review and approval authority over manuscripts, that sounds an awful lot like a pharmaceutical company wanting to censor publications to an Office of Grants and Contracts, and that causes problems and has caused problems across this country. Whereas if you think of those folks as co-authors, who, as any co-author, has a right to contribute to a manuscript and challenge a manuscript, then you sidestep those concerns. Although we should also engage our Offices of Grants and Contracts and sponsored programs around how these contracts are very different things than the contracts that they have with pharmaceutical companies. And we also then thought a lot more detail about how to present the results of our research to community members. Most of our reports in the scientific literature, they're unavailable, number one, to people with the access to information resources that people in reservation communities have. But number two, even if they could access them, they wouldn't read them or take the messages out of them that we think are in there. And so as part of our commitment to giving back the results of our research to communities and giving them the review and approval over the publications, we also now prepare simple community summaries with what we think are the main lessons for community members. I want to talk briefly about some of the ways in which life has changed for us since that conference, which really, for me in my career, changed several of the things that I was thinking I was doing. And this includes our efforts in training new investigators, a broader commitment to addressing directly health and healthcare disparities in American Indian Alaska Native communities, and the way in which I, in particular, have tried to combine these approaches in our American Indian Alaska Native Head Start Research Center. As I said, our Native Investigator Program began with funding from the National Institute on Aging. It began in 1997, and we're now training our fifth cohort of junior faculty, all of whom are Native. They all have faculty positions, and so what we have done is allowed them, we haven't asked them to move to Denver, given the precarious nature of funding for any of our salaries where we work, which is entirely grant funded. That's not a very attractive offer to make to people who generally have tenured hard money positions where they work. But what we do is we free up a third of their time through subcontracts with their institution to devote entirely to research training. Because what we've heard from all of the junior faculty who we've trained is that the problem isn't so much for them finding a junior faculty position. The problem for them is finding the time, once you have that position, to become to create a research career. And that's what the program's designed to do. And culminates with their writing a K award to free up three quarters of their time for research for the next 5 years when they leave our program. We give them access to our data. We collect a lot of data. We have a lot of resources to help them think through questions that are relevant to them, and if not, we can help them access colleagues' data, national data, that can support the kinds of analyses that they want to do that leads to a publication. We then give them money for pilot data collection with an identified tribal partner so that they actually get some experience collecting data. And then, as I said, in the end, we have them write a grant proposal to release even more of their time so that they can continue to flourish as academic investigators. I don't think that we're overestimating our impact on the field. When we started this, there were 3 NIH-funded Native investigators. We have now generated, through people involved in this program, 80 grant applications, 70% of which have been successful. As you know, NIH's payline now is around 15-20%. So this is a dramatic impact. The number of Native investigators has tripled, and all of them almost all of them bear some relationship to our training program. We have also contributed to the development of community-based organizations. Several of our Native investigators, instead of going to university jobs, have created community-based research organizations, including most notably the Black Hills Center for American Indian Health, which Jeff Henderson, a Lakota physician, one of the members of our first cohort, has established in Rapid City, South Dakota. And Jeff brings in millions of dollars a year to conduct tribally directed research on health concerns in the Northern Plains. We've also, one of our graduates is now a senior researcher at the South Central Foundation in Alaska, which is the nonprofit arm of the Cook Inlet Tribal Corporation in the Anchorage area. Our Center on American Indian Alaska Native Health Disparities, as I said, was funded by the National Center for Minority Health and Health Disparities, and reflects our expanded commitment to addressing health disparities broadly, but using the kinds of knowledge and expertise we have in behavioral intervention. We're not going to pretend to be molecular biologists or endocrinologists or anything like that, although that knowledge and skill is also required for addressing some of the health disparities in Indian communities. But our emphasis has been on what contributions behavioral science can make to alleviating health disparities. And in particular, I want to talk about a project that I'm leading where we're developing an approach to preventing pediatric obesity in first-time moms in the Northern Plains. As I said at the outset, diabetes, and I wish I had figures from the 21st century to give you, but diabetes is one of the most, if not the most, pressing health priorities in many American Indian Alaska Native communities. And physical activity and nutrition have become very salient topics in the discourse of any American Indian community that I know of. As I said, we fund half of the programs that are funded under our coordinating center for the Indian Health Service are focused on lifestyle interventions to prevent diabetes. And all of those communities have active in multiple areas in trying to change the patterns of diet and activity in their communities. There's, as you know, probably many of you know, there's a substantial investment in understanding childhood obesity and preventing childhood obesity. And these interests in communities in preventing diabetes link quite naturally to the resources that are available to talk about childhood obesity. And what we've developed is, in collaboration with partners in the Northern Plains tribe, is an approach that seeks to intervene in physical activity and nutrition at the earliest possible point, and that is in the last trimester of a mom's first pregnancy. And that's based on our colleague David Old's model of the nurse-family partnership, where again, they target first-time mothers in the last trimester of pregnancy. Primary prevention is key. If you know what little we know in the area of treatment of obesity, treatment of obesity is extremely difficult compared to trying to prevent it primarily. We also know, though, that by preschool, over 50% of the children in this community are already overweight or obese. So if you're going to intervene, you really have to intervene while they're in the womb if you want to have an impact on what's going on. We don't know a lot about infant risk factors for obesity, but what we do know points to the importance of regulatory processes more generally. There are isolated findings, certainly with regard to feeding, some with regard to sleep, and certainly with regard to activity once kids are mobile, that suggest that all of those processes laid down in the first few months of life have an impact on subsequent weight gain. As I said, our goal is to build on the lessons learned by our colleague David Olds, to intervene with first-time moms before the child is born, and to do so in culturally congruent ways. And we're going to do this through a local hospital, but because they have such problem getting people into prenatal visits, into well-child visits, we're going to do that through the local hospital, but in the family's homes. I would say that there are a few places now where strictly home-based intervention probably makes sense. As we learned in the National Evaluation of Early Head Start, when a large number of the programs that originally intended to be entirely home-based had to shift their model in the wake of welfare reform, as it came to be known, that has had less of an impact on the way in which you'd want to deliver services in reservation communities, at least to date. The community has participated in all aspects of this process. This was developed jointly with interested community partners. The materials have been authored jointly with them, and in particular, we've decided we needed to respond to their concern that if we were going to ultimately engage in a randomized controlled trial, which I think we need to convince people this works, or to even find out if it works, the need to give something to everybody who in an environment where I just told you there's hardly any specialty care available at all. So we've worked with our community partners to develop informational brochures that emphasize the content of the home visits that will be available to everybody in the clinic. We also heard very clearly about people's disappointment with directive interventions where people are told what to do. And fortunately, we were able to draw on existing models of intervention that are non-directive, motivational interviewing in particular, which allow for a great deal of respect for individual autonomy and decision making that other approaches to intervention change really do not. Indeed, I have a colleague at the University of New Mexico who is a student of Bill Miller's, who's the chief author of motivational interviewing, who is a native clinical psychologist, does most of her work in the addictions. And she has created a native training manual for motivational interviewing. Kamala Venner is her name. And if you're interested, I can send you her website because it's available free for downloading. But as she sat down with intertribal groups in New Mexico area to talk about motivational interviewing, she was struck repeatedly by how much people felt that this was something that Native communities had been doing all along and really was a Native approach to healing, even though Bill Miller is not Native and Kamala was not involved in the original authorship of the approach. We were talking about this at lunch with regard to the research I do in alcoholism as well, that the sentiment I encountered with regard to Alcoholics Anonymous and the emphasis on spiritual solutions to a problem with substances also was felt by most of the Native community members that I talked to as being something that was derived from Native wisdom and the importance of spirituality and healing. This was, I think, though singly, the most important lesson we learned. There's a lot of resources devoted to childhood obesity. We were talking about this as the Obesity Project. People said, we don't really care about body size. I mean, look at us, we're all big. That is not the issue. The issue to us is diabetes and the consequences of diabetes. And what you need to emphasize to people isn't that you're going to keep their children from putting on weight, but that what you're going to do is you're going to set their children up to keep them from becoming diabetic with all the consequences that people see from diabetes. And so we've dramatically reoriented all of those materials, and I don't think they even make reference to obesity anymore, because that's simply not the point to people in these communities. And there is emerging literature in physical activity that suggests that even if you don't lose weight, physical activity will still insulate you from many of the consequences that are of greatest concern from obesity, because they turn out not necessarily to be consequences of obesity, but to be consequences of inactivity, which obesity promotes. So it certainly helps to lose some weight, but that's not necessarily, the causal relationship is not clear. Let me just close by talking about the work we're doing in our Head Start Research Center. ACF for years had tried to encourage research in tribal programs and had failed repeatedly. Our colleague Tina Mitchell, who actually trained here decades ago in community psychology, was the only person in I think the last 10 to 20 years that had a research grant from the Administration on Children and Families that was focused on a tribal program. And that was a project that I directed that led to our line of research in infancy. Our center was, and most recently, 2 to 3 years ago, they had made $2 million available to universities. And they got one application, and I reviewed it. And I won't tell you who it is, because that would be illegal. It was awful. There was no good work out there. Even when you dangled $2 million out in front of a bunch of university-based investigators, they couldn't generate good proposals. So in 2004, they decided that maybe they needed to take a different approach and to create a center that would be funded to people with closer connections in Indian communities that might be able to seed research. And that's what we tried to do. We have three primary components: research training on the model of the Native Investigator Program that I was talking to you about earlier, a local research program, and then we added, in response to our steering committee and also the request of our federal partners, because it's a cooperative agreement, mining the available data on Indian and Native Head Start so that we could see what we could say about the predicaments in which those programs operate. And those of you who are Head Start directors know that you generate a lot of data for ACF, and you'll be happy to know that we are actually using it, and it is showing us some very interesting things. We decided that we were not in the position to direct the center, although we feel like we know a fair amount about doing research in Indian communities. We recognized that really program experience was vital if we were to really make a go of engaging communities in research. And we decided that a ratio of 2-to-1 was probably reasonable, because researchers they have their voices, and we wanted to be sure that program folks were heard as well. This is the current composition of our steering committee. We actually at one point had 11 program directors, and we've lost a couple of researchers that we've added through our local partnerships. We met 3 times over the first year to give shape to all the center efforts. We created calls for application both for research partnerships and for junior faculty trainees. And then, as I said, we've identified, with help from our federal partners, numerous sources of data on American Indian, Alaska Native Head Starts and early Head Starts. ACF had funded through ORC Macro a set of listening sessions throughout tribal communities in the country to try and develop a research agenda for American Indian Alaska Native Head Start. And this is when they made the $2 million available that no one was able to compete for. So they had originally articulated a very comprehensive research agenda. We sat down with our steering committee, shared that with them, and identified what they thought were the most important priorities within that research agenda, because it's huge, and that's no way to focus effort. All of our local research projects require partnerships. So although the subcontracts are to universities, and that's how ACF proceeds, and I want to say something about that at the end, they are required to have and fund program and community participation in their research. And all of them are engaged now in the steering committee process and were participants in our meeting in February, and are benefiting from the learning that occurs across programs and across programs and researchers as part of that steering committee process. We realized on our first site visit to one of our partners that we had asked our investigators if there were concerns about identifying their communities, and had heard that there were not. But when we went on our first site visit, the tribal communities with which they're partnered, when we went on our first site visit, we actually realized that there were concerns, and the tribal partner in particular had concerns about what might come of the research and how that might be publicized and the impact it would have on the community. So I'm not going to tell you the tribes with which folks are partnered, but I do want to tell you a little bit about what emerged as, to us, a very intriguing focus of these local research projects. Head Start Research, the Administration on Children and Families, now organized under the Office of Planning, Research, and Evaluation, has historically been research on child development outcomes in Head Start contexts. One of the things that emerged really clearly in our discussions with our steering committee was that from a program director's perspective, some of the major issues that they were dealing with were staff development, recruitment, retention. And so they really emphasized to us repeatedly that what they wanted to do was research on staff. And so we argued for and successfully got that as part of the RFA. Even after we had funded the local research projects, we went to talk to the Office of Head Start, and they remained skeptical about how you do research on staff development, which is something I think we might want to talk about, because it seems obvious to me, but it didn't seem to them the kind of thing that Head Start research should be funding. But this was emphasized in all of our discussions, and interestingly, we had 9 applications for these local research partnerships. The 3 that we ended up funding all focused on staff. The most powerful applications with the best partnerships between programs and universities all emphasized staff development, and all emphasized staff development within attempts to integrate culture into the curriculum. Because one of the challenges is, and those of you who are program directors in American Indian Alaska Native Head Starts know, is that your most qualified cultural staff probably are not the most qualified in terms of the credentials they're supposed to be having. And so how you create the kind of environment in which you can have those both qualifications is a major challenge. We also have three junior faculty who are participating in a second training program. They weren't able to join the cohort of the Native Investigator program. They're in an off year. They just started this year. They're all from colleges of education. They're all moving to early childhood from backgrounds in elementary education because of the problems they see for Native students already in elementary education, and they feel at preschool and early infancy offer the best opportunity for beginning to change some of those trajectories in the educational system. As I said, all are motivated primarily to develop preventive interventions for the kinds of consequences that affect people in school, Native people in school. We're working with them currently with our data sets in early childhood to give them their first publications in early childhood, and we're working with all of them now as they develop partnerships with tribal programs to think about what kinds of research might better serve those programs. Just let me close by talking about some new directions in which we're going. One of the very exciting programs, it's actually funded by our National Center for Minority Health and Health Disparities, is training local community health practitioners in the use of information technology to develop and evaluate educational interventions for health promotion and health and prevention. And we now have three cohorts of people who've come to train in our building, which has a considerable investment in information technology, real-time video conferencing and the like, through our Center for Native American Telehealth and Teleeducation. One of which, a program in breast cancer awareness, a DVD that a tribal member prepared on breast cancer awareness and the importance of screening, has been taken national by the Indian Health Service. So we're extremely proud of the work we've been able to do there. We've developed just now a certificate program for faculty in tribal colleges and universities who are interested in health services research. As I said, pretty much the only interest anybody has in Native research, health research now, have to have a focus on intervention services or policy. We've created a certificate so that faculty from TCUs who are interested in this research can get the training and then have plans then to support them as they develop pilot projects. We're actively involved in outreach to undergraduates, interestingly, through our program in the computational biosciences of all places. As we've developed our focus on genomic research, we've become aware of efforts on our campus to recruit and retain minority scientists. Our program in the computational biosciences, which is how genomics gets done, had identified, independent of us, because of where we are in the country, a focus on Hispanic and American Indian undergraduates, and getting people who are interested in the sciences, the computer sciences in particular, to think about the applications of computer science to biology. We also have a growing commitment to using different mechanisms at NIH to actually sit down with community members and develop interventions. My colleague Doug Novins, the child and adolescent psychiatrist I was telling you about at the outset, is currently engaged in an effort to better address trauma in the context of residential substance abuse treatment program for adolescents. And my colleague Michelle Sarchet, who runs the training program of our Head Start Center, has two projects under review, one to look at services for children of substance abusing parents, and one to look at school-based services for traumatized youth. And again, both using this kind of qualitative community-based approach to developing and modifying interventions. And as I said, some of the most intriguing activity is actually in the area of the computational biosciences for us, which is funny. I was puzzling over this with somebody this morning about the most substantial commitment you have in all of the National Institutes of Health to community-based participatory research is at the Genome Institute. The most arcane, most technical of all of the institutes is the one that does the best job, and they don't do an adequate job, I think anybody would agree, but the one that has the most substantial commitment to funding community-based participatory research. As I said, I can't tell you about the health status of Native people in the 21st century, and we're in 2007. We clearly need to know some basic epidemiology. But I think that there's a very real set of questions on the priority of that information in light of what we might learn by just simply doing interventions. And communities and programs clearly want to just get down to doing intervention. I think an interesting question for those of us who are engaged in community work To think about is to what extent you can generate information on health status through actually intervening or changing service structures or changing policies. But I think we need to know something about epidemiology, but that old model of prevention science where you need to have all the epi and all the risk factors and all the protective factors articulated in advance before you attempt to intervene on any of them, communities have no patience for. But I think there is a role clearly for basic research in generating basic information on the health status of Native people, and I think we are puzzling over what that role is and should be. I want to just close by talking about an alternate model that we're going to explore, at least in that we propose to explore in a pending application of mine. As I said, our partnership grants in the Head Start Research Center are grants to universities. And so from a community perspective, it's a university come knocking, talking about wanting to do a study again. What would it look like if we gave research grants to communities and let them decide who to partner with and what to study? There's been a substantial investment by the Indian Health Service and the National Institute of General Medical Sciences, interestingly, in what are called Native American Research Centers for Health. And these go to tribal and tribally sanctioned research enterprises like the Black Hills Center for American Indian Health that I was talking about earlier. And one of the things that we're exploring and actually currently working on is ways to send dollars directly to those institutions so that they can direct the research under tribal control. And we want to explore ways to fund and support local research directly. And one of the notable examples that I'm currently involved in is, again, working with the South Central Foundation, the nonprofit in the Anchorage area, as they develop plans for actually doing community-based research on genomics using repositories and tissue banks that already have been collected in the context of multiple other investigations in their area. Engaging with communities around discussions about what to do with those resources, what kind of studies should be supported, how they should be controlled, all of which would be under the control of the corporation in the Anchorage area. And there's some very exciting things that we hope to explore if someone will give us the money to give the money directly to the tribes to lead the research. And I think that's really the next logical stage in the evolution of our work, so that universities become the resource to tribes that they're supposed to be to all communities, and rather than telling people what to do, or even jointly articulating with people what to do, they become the resource that people turn to when they've decided what they themselves want to do. So that's it. I'm happy to take questions. I think I have a few minutes. Yeah, a few minutes.
Yeah, 25 minutes.
Or if not, let's go snack.
Any questions for Paul?
Can you elaborate on some of that staff research that you've seen? The staff research?
Oh, and highest potentially in a better position to do that. These are projects we have just now funded, but all of them focus to some extent on helping Native staff and Native programs to meet the requirements that are now promulgated for teachers in Head Start and early Head Start. And that's a challenge for all Head Start programs, but it's a challenge that is felt particularly acutely for the staff of American Indian Alaska Native programs who lack access to, in many cases, lack access to the educational resources, whose staff are reluctant to engage in the educational system to get those qualifications. There's a set of issues around giving staff the training for which that is now technically required of Head Start and early Head Start staff. And then there's a set of issues around how you do that in a way that allows them to continue to maintain culture in the classroom. I don't know, Hi, if you want to say anything about your particular effort at this stage, but all three of those projects, even though we gave them a chance to focus on child outcomes, on classroom practice, on staff issues, and on the needs of families and children, we thought we were going to get all the research on the needs of families and children. We didn't get a single proposal. We got one proposal for that of the nine. All three of the proposals that were the strongest and that we ended up funding are focused on these fundamental questions of how you give your staff the qualifications that they're now required to get. I don't know. At this stage, there's nothing more to say about what they're doing because they're all just getting started. But that was striking to us that from the program directors in our steering committee all emphasized repeatedly, and in the face of some opposition from our federal partners, that about the importance of giving people the opportunity to do research on staff development. And in the end, that's what we're doing. So I thought that was just an interesting example.
And when you ask them, it's think that the issue is just not sufficient resources to provide the training. So where is the research to make the argument for additional funding?
For those resources. Yeah, well, that'll emerge, certainly, as people try and give their staff the training and they identify the barriers to doing so. I think all of our local research projects have a commitment to improving access to the training resources that are out there, using a variety of very interesting approaches. I think if those efforts don't accomplish all that's hoped for, then you have some substantial evidence about the need to rethink those requirements or the need to make available other kinds of opportunities for staff to develop those competencies. So I think that there's an example of where we would hope that research that's really research on intervention, it's intervention with staff, actually does generate some basic information that is used to argue for additional resources.
On the research that found that as people's income increases, so does alcoholism.
You mean to replicate that finding?
No, to try to understand the finding.
So the argument has been, and there have been a couple of other examples where revenue has flowed directly to tribal members, and where you have seen elevated levels of consumption. The interpretation that emerges from that is that if you don't address the underlying reasons that people have recourse to alcohol, and you simply give them more resources for it, then they will use those resources for those alcohol problems. But there is a very interesting example from the Eastern Band of Cherokee in North Carolina. Jane Costello did a study there. Her study wasn't focused on Native issues, but included an oversample of people living in that area. And when that tribe opened a casino, there were some dramatic changes in child psychopathology. And in particular, what changed were the externalizing cluster of symptoms. And these are kids who are generally too young to have substance abuse problems, but as Hai can tell you, those externalizing problems are often a risk factor for subsequent substance abuse problems. And when the revenue flowed into that community, those externalizing problems dropped. The internalizing problems didn't change. Depression, anxiety, and the like. But the behavior problems dropped. So there is some evidence to suggest that wouldn't necessarily be the natural consequence of increased income in a community, that their substance abuse problems would just get worse, because some of the problems that underlie substance abuse problems, aggression and the like, are actually ameliorated when income goes up. And so I don't think we really understand it clearly, but the interpretation in those studies that have found that effect when people just simply have more money is that they have more money to drink with if you haven't addressed their underlying alcohol problems.
But another assumption could be that people get more money by becoming more disciplined or being in more disciplined type situations. And the question could be, why doesn't that generalize more to self-control?
Because in this case, it's not by virtue of anything they did in terms of changing their way in the world. These are just monies that were made available because the tribe had a windfall. And so that it's not like they were working, which I think you would have, I would then predict what you're predicting there. They simply had more money and the same amount of time on their hands and the same bad habits. Yeah. But the example from Eastern North Carolina is an intriguing counterexample. I think it suggests some of the complexity there that we really don't know.
Yeah. Dwight? You spoke of physical activity. Physical activity as being used to promote health and wellness. And I was curious about the process of what that might look like, and also how did you engage the community in defining that?
In terms of thinking about physical activity?
Yeah.
And especially in these communities where people are very concerned about safety issues on the streets and with the dogs and the snakes in the northern plains where we work. People have the opinion, though, that aboriginally they were very active, very fit people. And so when they think about physical activity, they think about reclaiming that element of their heritage, and that's what they would like for their children, is for them to be active, vigorous, and involved in daily activity. They running, for example, there's a proud tradition in this community, and they have some very very famous track stars, long distance running stars, in communities in this area. And so people think about and point to that as an example of what they think their children should be. But there's another question you may be asking, which is, what does that look like for a six-month-old child? And they're not running. They may be crawling. You'd hope they're sitting up. One option is to extend it to a point where the kid is running and to think about what to do with children once they actually are mobile. But the community ended up wanting to do is just to set the stage for activity in the family. These are first-time moms. And they said, well, we should encourage moms just to take a walk with their child in a stroller. And so that the child gets used to being out and gets used to not moving themselves, but to the sensation of movement, to that being a part of the family routine. And I'm not sure, I mean, those are the thoughts that occur to me in response to your question. I have no idea if I answered it.
What their ideas of physical activity may be, but also how you try to, what ideas that you brought them to encourage physical activity. And I'm beginning to kind of look at that interface about your professional self.
It's interesting. One of the things, people in this community are avid basketball fans, and people, you know, through their high school years remain vigorous in their physical activity. But almost immediately afterwards, stop entirely. I used to work for in a community, and they referred to the NBA as the high school basketball league, and that was to them the height of ambition was to succeed in the high school basketball and to stop there. So that would be another example of a kind of culturally valorized activity that you might mobilize people around. Again, not with a six-month-old child. You're going to have them, you know, practicing their jump shot. But there are cultural traditions of activity that people seek to tap into and to revitalize in the course of working with first-time moms and having them think about what their children might do. Way in back, and then I'll come on. Actually, how you know people's
way
names.
Way in back, and then George.
I was thinking, well, you know, then it's really hard to do comparative work. It's really hard to think about the specificities of community histories, community environments. And then you gave the example of the corporation in Alaska and how devastating that was when the community was not anonymous. But then you talked about the Native American Research Centers for Health, which are clearly going to be identified with communities. So I'm just wondering, if you could comment on this sort of paradox that we need to protect communities, communities deserve that right, but at the same time, it is important that communities be recognized.
One of our tribal partners actually doesn't care about community confidentiality, but they're involved in a study with three tribes, two of whom care deeply about community confidentiality, and so as a consequence, they don't get identified either, even though they wouldn't care if we were to identify them. The Black Hills Center on American Indian Health works throughout the Billings and Aberdeen area. There's 20 plus tribes. And so Jeff's ability to protect the confidentiality of any particular tribe is as great as ours when we use the geographic designation Northern Plains. So there's an example of a NARCS where you wouldn't necessarily be able to identify the specific communities where the studies had been done. South Central Foundation also represents some 20 different Alaska Native villages, so you wouldn't necessarily know what particular village that was. But on the other hand, these are all tribally sanctioned or tribally controlled research enterprises, and those are decisions they can make with the tribes that they're working for in terms of who gets identified when, under what circumstances. In our TA work, in our information dissemination work, in our clinical work through the real-time video conferencing, all of the tribes allow us to and encourage us to identify them. They're proud of the innovations in their healthcare systems that they've been able to create. So it really is, I think, a function, it's a local decision, first and foremost, but it's a function of what you're studying and what the potential implications are. But I agree, as an anthropologist, it was initially incredibly frustrating for me to be working in a defined community with, in many cases, very well-established ethnographic literature so that we have a sense of how communities are organized, what their histories have been, that shed some light on some of the things we're seeing and not being able to cite that directly. at least. And so you end up with these kind of cultural area glosses there. So, you know, I think there are situations where tribes would say that's fine. And even in the case of our research on alcohol, drug, and mental health disorders, there are tribal partners we have that say that would be fine if you identified us. But we don't do that because it's an agreement we've made between three tribes, not just that tribe. And so we don't identify any of the tribes that participated in that study. But that is a tension, and it is a very real frustration. And certainly the work we do in terms of community feedback and giving back to communities, that's what gets into the scientific literature. Communities obviously know we were there working with them, and they know their histories. And so as we think through the implications of some findings, our grant proposals name our communities. And the few times that people have requested our applications through Freedom of Information requests, our program officers, thankfully, have been all too helpful in stripping out the tribal IDs before that becomes public, because they understand the nature of the commitments we've made to tribes. And that doesn't happen very often that somebody wants your grant application, you know, fortunately. But communities, if they're applying for resources based on needs that our research has identified, they can identify themselves in their grant application. They can talk about their history and the like. So the limitation is more in terms of what gets into the scientific literature than how it's of use to communities. And again, there are ample number of instances where communities might decide that it's fine to be identified, but generally not in research in alcoholism. People don't want to be identified. George.
Yeah, I was just interested in your thoughts on you direct the National Center that has a very research intensive agenda, and you would outline some of the hurdles, you know, that you had encountered and identified in engaging with American Indian communities, engaging in research. And I was just wondering on, you know, some of your thoughts from your experience working with Native communities on health issues in terms of, you know, how do you really engage in effective outreach with American Indian communities, and how do you work to build bridges, you know, between the community and this other end of the spectrum that you work at, and kind of bring things all right together so it results in effective training and
right
making a difference, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, what do you see are some of the really important components of working with these communities?
We have a current project on trust in research, and one of the major issues that emerged in our first round of tribal discussions, and we're exploring trust more generally, why virtually no community in Colorado trusts our medical school. But we want to, the point of departure there was the way in which trust emerged as a really central issue in the national discussions we were having around research in American Indian Alaska Native communities. And the what people keep coming back to and emphasizing, and not that we have, although I was suggesting over lunch that we actually do have a large body of theory we could draw on, what people emphasize repeatedly is the importance of the relationship and the investment in that relationship independent of any particular project. And in the case of our most long-term tribal partners, we have field offices that have been open well into their second decade, in some cases into their third decade. We don't have any of the same staff. I don't think that'll surprise you. But those offices have been a presence in those communities for decades. And the tribe knows us as the University of Colorado. That's how they think of us. So we hope our colleagues from Boulder don't go in there and mess things up for us. But that's how we're seen. And because of our track record in staying in those communities and developing long-term lines of research on issues of importance to them in child and adolescent health, in diabetes and the like, there is a certain level of trust that we've worked to maintain that is beyond any particular project. I think the predicament for health researchers in general, and we were talking about this in lunch too, is that we live such project-driven lives. I mean, everything I do is a grant, and it's all for very specific purposes for a very specific study. And if you're just going to do this grant here, and this grant here, and this grant here, then you contribute to that sense that Native communities have, that researchers are just here for the data, and they're going to leave, and leave you with nothing. If you make an investment in staying in those communities, and that means that we don't have the geographic diversity in some of our basic research that many people would like, but we've done that. It's been a conscious decision to maintain those relationships with some of those very dear tribal partners for some of our basic research. So I think that's one issue. The other is a demonstrated commitment to building capacity for local research through outreach to the undergraduates that are at the tribal colleges and universities, through creating opportunities for graduate students that are interested in research, and through supporting tribal members who are junior faculty who need release time in order to succeed as academics. And making that investment, those investments, and also the investment we make in the career trajectories of our research staff in our field offices, I think demonstrates another level of commitment to those communities and to doing research in a different way. But I think the best way to do it would be to trust communities to do their research and to make ourselves available, as I said at the end, to make ourselves available to do what they see as most important and to create the opportunity for that kind of dialogue. In which case we've basically reversed the power relations that dominate in current research. And there it's a question, if they don't trust us, they can just go find someone else, you know? So they have the say in shaping how the research gets done. So those are some thoughts, but I think we haven't invested, probably folks at the National Center have invested more energy than any of us in thinking about the elements of what creates a successful research relationship between a university and communities. And I think we really need to start getting some of these lessons into print so that we can build that knowledge base.
Yeah, I think one of the keys is the extent to which the community is a co-creator of the research design methodology. If the partnership really is co-creative in determining how you're going to get to the end point, then all along the way, the community can be identifying exactly what they want out of the project. So, from the faculty member's perspective, we want to be able to do scholarly work and publish our findings based on successful program interventions. From the community's perspective, they probably don't care about whether we publish our findings or not, but they have their set of outcomes that they want, and if they're part of that process of designing everything, those outcomes become identified all along the way as well, and they're community-driven. So that's another way to sort of go about achieving a stronger community voice in what's related to the project.
Yeah, I was really kind of interested in that because, I mean, I think there are only two Indian tribes in Colorado, weren't there?
We work across the country, yeah.
Yeah, no, that's what I mean. But, I mean, they're way down in the southwestern corner, I think, and so you really have to build some strong relationships with folks.
Over distance, yeah.
Yeah, and I know Colorado had a hand in working with the rise of the tribal college movement and supporting some of the other stuff that's really kind of helped to build some of those bridges.
It's interesting the number of national Native organizations that are located in the Denver metro area, in part because it is kind of neutral ground. I mean, there's a substantial urban population there, but there are no tribes that are in that immediate area along the Front Range of Colorado. And so it's at the cross sections of a lot of different areas of Native communities, but is somewhat neutral.
I would also say I agree 150% of your responses in terms of how you work with Native communities. I mean, that element of trust is critical, you know, and starting out and being in those communities for a long period of time and putting your best foot forward and then collaborating and you know, the whole notion of capacity building is so important in these communities, you know, that people have to solve their own problems over time, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I entirely agree.
We hope you all have at least another half hour of your time. We have a reception in the Red Cedar Room. You're all welcome to come and continue to talk to Paul or to each other. So please join me in the next.